There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to family. There's always room for more. When I count my blessings, it's easy to see my brothers and sisters that mean so much to me. Kept me in their prayers, and the countless ways they've always shown me that they care. And I know they'll still walk with me no matter what's ahead. Yeah, so much more than just their words, their lives have always said. Welcome to the family, you can feel it. Years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family. You can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family. Always room for more.
It was late Sunday night, the car door closed softly, footsteps came up the stairs. Young Pastor Tony met his wife at the entrance, his face lined with a thousand cares. We've been here 2 years and nothing's changed. These people won't listen at all. I'm out of answers and I'm feeling small. But as he read in the Bible, page after page, his heart was convinced to stay in the race. He knelt by his desk, then lay on the floor. Though we don't understand what it's for, I'll trust one day more. I'll pray again, I'll kneel again, I'll knock on the door, ask him for more strength for the fight, peace in the night, trusting by faith the answer he'll send. Two again in the morning, a mother wakes up again. Her youngest daughter has a special condition. They say that she won't pass 10. The worry's so great, and nothing's changed. Does God understand us at all? We're out of answers and we're feeling small. But as she read in the Bible, page after page, the comfort came in right along with grace. Her hand held her daughter's as they knelt on the floor. Though we don't understand what it's for, we'll trust one day more. We'll pray again. We'll kneel again. We'll knock on the door. Ask him for more strength for the fight, peace in the night. Trusting by faith, the answer he'll send. We'll pray again. When the darkness surrounds you and God seems so silent, your back's against the wall, you may be tempted to doubt God's goodness. It seems like he won't hear your call. The questions take shape and cloud your mind. Is God in control after all? My life's out of balance and I'm going to fall. But if you'll read in the Bible, page after page, you'll see that he's there and he'll never forsake. Surrender your life is all you must do. You'll begin to see God's point of view. He's there to change you. Go pray again. Go kneel again. Go knock on the door. Ask him for more strength for the fight, peace in the night. Trusting by faith, the answer he'll send.
They're not mine at all. For blessings you have given, or the joys you've promised are in store. So as I bow before you, give me the words to express my deepest thanks. Not for what you've given, but Lord, for what you took away.
Shame, and all my sinful blame became as yours. You opened wide your hands, as a guilty man, you wore my crown of thorns. You took the death I earned, and all that I deserved,
most of all, thanks for what you took from me. Father, please forgive me for all the times I failed to mention this before. I've been so concerned with treasures, I went so far as to even ask for more. But you've shown me, Lord, what's precious. It's not the things you've given me today. For their worth to me is nothing when compared to what you took away.
You took my guilt and shame, and all sinful blame became as yours. You opened wide your hands, as a guilty man, you wore my crown of thorns. You took the death I earned, and all that I deserved on Calvary.
But most of all,
thanks for what you took from me.
You took the death I earned, and all that I deserved on Calvary. given. But most of all, thanks for what you took from me.
What you took from me.
Joshua chapter 5, please. We're looking at how to have a success in the coming year, in the new year. We're just early in 2017. God wants us to have a great life. And as the children of Israel are prepared to go across the Jordan River into Canaan land, it is a picture of a new life in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he tells us how to be victorious in our living for the Lord. They're going to go into the promised land. They're going to enjoy the bounty and the abundance and the wonderful things that are there. And God tells us how to be successful in doing that. And so that's why we've chosen the book of Joshua. And we're picking out chapters that talk about how to be successful in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so reading chapter 5, verse 1, and it came to pass when all the kings of the Amorites, which were on the side of Jordan westward, and all the kings of the Canaanites, which were by the sea, heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of Jordan from before the children of Israel until they were passed over, that their hearts melted, neither was their spirit in them anymore because of the children of Israel. Heavenly Father, bless the reading of your word. Instruct us, God, on how to live a successful life in Christ Jesus. Lord, we know that there's battles to be fought. We know that there's troubles that will come our way. We know that Satan is still our adversary. And yet, Father, as we look at these great chapters, how you work on behalf of your people, God, we can enjoy the same victories in life if we apply these principles to our own lives. Save the loss that would be in our service today. Strengthen and encourage the believer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. When you get a new job, maybe you switch jobs, you go to a new place, one of the first things you have to do is learn the rules of the place. And so you're brand new, and you've got to find out what their standards are, what their rules are, what do they expect, and you try to fit into that policy to the very best that you can. And try to support the company that you work for. Try to be a good employee and hopefully maybe even work your way up in it. The spiritual life there's very little difference in it. God has a standard and policy. Well, the Bible calls them commandments in the Bible that he wants us to follow. Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And so there's rules. And it's amazing how we will fit into the policies and the rules of a business, but often we fight against God and his rules and his commandments. Maybe it's because we don't see God and the other guy is paying our salary or, you know, whatever. And so we try harder to adapt to those rules than we do God's rules. But wise is the person who will try to adapt to God's commandments if you're looking for a successful life. It just makes sense. Matter of fact, I found that over the years that this earthly life is just really very similar to the spiritual life. We live this life so that we can see the spiritual life. Our families, our churches, our children, God's kindness, all these things are carried out and played out in life so that we can see how God works and God we can't see. But the children of Israel are going into the promised land. This is what has been promised them, and God says, this is a wonderful, wonderful land, a wonderful experience I want you to enjoy. But there are conditions. And if you'll follow these certain things, you can have a wonderful, wonderful life. Will there be battles over there? Yes. You know, will there be problems? Will there be health issues? Yes. But your best chance of success is if you'll follow my commandments and follow my leadership. And so let's quickly look this morning In chapters 5 and 6, this is where they go in and fight the battle of Jericho. You remember the story. But let's just briefly touch on four or five topics that can apply to our own lives. Number one, the first thing we see is the battle is won by remembering who's in charge. Who's in charge? Just as and we talked last week about this, that the Israelites had to sanctify themselves spiritually before they would be prepared to cross over the Jordan River. Now the men, the Bible tells us in these first 9-10 verses, that they had to be circumcised to affirm the covenant that they had with the Lord. And verses 2 through 8 talks about this. This was a custom, and this was a command that God gave to the children of Israel, that all the male children had to be circumcised. Why did he do this? It was a sign of a covenant to them, but it was a picture of them, a spiritual picture of them, removing anything that stood between them and their God. Any fleshly desires, any fleshly lusts, anything fleshly that would stand between them and God had to be removed. And this was symbolic of the spiritual side of their life. And so circumcision was a covenant that God made with Israel. And it is symbolic of them removing, again, from their heart all fleshly lusts and so on. And that command was given to the Jews in Genesis chapter 17, verse 11 through 13. This was a ordinance between God and Israel. And we see this laid out here in verses 2 through 9. And you have to understand that there was also a time of healing. While the healing went on for the men, they were vulnerable to an enemy attack, but God protected them. And how do we know that? Because we read in verse 1 that those in Jericho, all the Canaanites, the Amorites, had heard how God had stopped the waters of Jordan River and allowed the children of Israel to go across on dry ground. And when they heard this, the Bible says their hearts melted, neither was their spirit in them anymore because of the children of Israel. So my point is, the first thing that the children of Israel had to do when they got across the Jordan River is they had to get right with God. During the 40 years that they wandered in the wilderness, they failed to keep this great commandment of God. And they did not do it for 40 years. It lay dormant while they were wandering through the wilderness. The generation, the adult generation passed away. All the new generation grew up, and they had failed to keep the ordinance that God commanded them. And so the point is, God says, you want this new life in Christ. You want the blessings that go with following me. It starts again with being right spiritually. I cannot encourage us all enough. If you're not saved, you ought to be saved. You need to get saved and give your life to Christ so that God can. If you are a Christian and you are saved, but you're still harboring things in your life that's against God and the commandments of God, you will never prosper. You'll never be as successful as God wants you to be as long as you do that. And so the first 9 verses talks about them having to fulfill this command that God gave them years ago, and they have failed to do this. God says, we're not going to go any further with this. I cannot bless you. You will not win the battle if you do not first keep my commandments. And I've never seen a day in Christianity when so many people are opposed to the commandments of God. God will not and cannot bless us if we rebel against the very things that he asks us to do. Also, with regard to the battles won by remembering who's in charge, in verse 13 through 15, we see once they've done this, once they got right with God, The Bible says in verse 13, and it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, art thou for us or for our adversaries? And so here's this, what appears to be an angel. It looks like a man. Joshua had obviously went to see the city of Jericho for himself. While there, this man appeared who had this sword drawn. But rather than engaging in a fight, Joshua asked the man if he's an adversary or a friend. Notice his response, nay or no. He says, I'm captain of the host of the Lord. This answer seems to surprise Joshua, but it's an answer that we would be wise to understand. You know, we often ask the question, is God for us? We often, it's like the Super Bowl. You know, I wonder what team the God's for. You know, it's so often like God's going to take sides in the Super Bowl. And so Joshua says, hey, are you a friend of ours? He says, this whoever he sees standing there with his sword in his hand, are you a friend or are you an enemy? And so he says in verse 14, he says, nay, but as the captain of the Lord of hosts am I now come. And once he said he was the captain of the Lord of the hosts, what did Joshua do? It says he fell on his face to the earth and did worship him. Who is this man? Christ, this most believe, and it just simply, without question, seems to be Christ's appearance. It's called a Christophany in the Old Testament, where Christ literally takes on the form of an individual and comes to talk to Joshua. Because the Bible says that Joshua fell down before him and began to worship him. Nowhere in the Bible are we allowed to worship angels. Matter of fact, when people attempted to worship angels in the Bible, the angel forbade it. He would not allow it. He says the only person you can worship is God. But in this particular case, the captain of the host of the Lord receives the worship of Joshua. The second thing we notice about it, if you follow that through 15, verse 15, and the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, loose thy shoes from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so. You remember that statement at the burning bush when Moses went and stood before God at the burning bush, and God says, hey, Moses, take your shoes off. You're standing on holy ground. The same statement is being made to Joshua. This is a statement that comes from God. And so it's very evident that this person is the incarnate Christ in the Old Testament. You say, is that possible? Absolutely. He appeared several times in the Old Testament. He came as a babe in the New Testament, but he made appearances in the Old Testament. You see, Jesus Christ is God. He can do what he wants to do. And so he made these appearances. And what was the purpose of it? He's wanting Joshua to know, now that you've done what God wants you to do, I will be with you. You're not alone in this thing. I will stand with you and I will fight for you. And this is the same thing in life. If you're following the commandments of the Lord, you're obeying him. You're trying to pattern your life after the word of God. Jesus says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will stand with you. I will fight your battles for you. We all need that if we hope in any way to be successful in this life. And so just as the Lord came to Joshua, just simply to reaffirm, hey, matter of fact, it's not even going to be your battle. It's going to be my battle. Some of you are facing battles today, and you don't know how you want to get through them. They seem to be impossible battles. Well, let me say, it isn't impossible. You can win the battle. You just got to know that God's for you, and how can God be for you? You need to be right with God. You see, it's not a matter, is God on your side. The question is, are you on God's side? That's the question. God says, Joshua, you did exactly what we asked you to do. You took that whole generation of people, and you did what we told you to do as far as circumcising the male children. And therefore, you followed us, you followed the word, you honored us, and we will stand for you. Most important thing we can do, we're going to be successful in this year and being successful in our Christian faith, is to put God first in our lives and make sure, as we said earlier, that we remember who is in charge. Secondly, God's methods are always the right methods. Verse 3 of chapter 6. He says, Joshua, here's how you're going to win the battle. Ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war. Now he lays it out very specifically. And go around about the city once. Thus shall you do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear before the ark 7 trumpets of ram's horns. And the 7th day ye shall compass the city 7 times. And the priests shall blow with the trumpets. And it shall come to pass that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the walls of the city shall fall down flat, and the people shall ascend up, every man straight before him. Okay, very specific rules. Again, God has his reasons for his rules and his commands. It's not ours to ask any more than our employer in the military. You just simply say, well, Sergeant, I don't like that rule. You don't get to do that. They have reasons for saying, we want you to do it this way. God is no different. He says, here, you got to understand, here's the specifics. When all the men of war to be up front, thousands and thousands and thousands of them, behind them will be 7 priests, and they will all have ram's horns, shofar horns. They will be blowing those horns. Behind him will be priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant. Even at the end, there will be some more armed people, the reward, people at the guards at the end. The people will be in there. But God was very specific even about the layout as to how they were to go about the city. You say, what difference does it make? It makes all the difference in the world. God says, I want it to be this way. And that's important for us to understand. Because often we don't understand what God is requiring and asking us of us. We just simply say, I think it would be better this way. And God says, no, no. If you expect to be successful and you want me to fight on your behalf, it has to be done this way. Now, there's no argument. They don't say, well, why don't we put the ark up front and put the soldiers behind and the priest blowing the trumpet someplace else. They don't do that. They do it just exactly as God tells them how to do it. And then he says, I want you to march around the city once every day for 6 days. Now some say it took about 2 hours to walk around the city. Now can you imagine the 7th day? And so they were to follow the ark, the priests who were carrying the horns, and of course the soldiers out front. And we see this again laid out in verses 7 through 9. And he said, and Joshua passes on to the people. And he said unto the people, pass on and compass the city. And let him that is armed pass on before the ark of the Lord. In other words, you guys go first. And it came to pass when Joshua had spoken to the people, that the 7 priests bearing the 7 trumpets of ram's horns passed on before the Lord, blew the trumpets, and the ark of the covenant of the Lord followed them. Very specific. And then verse 9, and the armed men went before the priest that blew the trumpets, and the reward came after the ark, and the priest going and blowing the trumpets. Very specific how it was to be done. And then on the seventh day, they're supposed to do that every day, one time a day. The seventh day, they were to march around the city seven times. When they hear the sound of the horns, they're to shout, and the walls will fall down. The Israelites are to contribute nothing to this, which is interesting. It is the Lord's battle. We need to give God our problems. He'll do far better than we will. Now, often when you give God the battle, he might use other people to help you. But God will go before you and open doors for you whereby you can be successful in the endeavor that you're engaged in. He will open the door where you can overcome the problem, or the problem will be taken care of and you can go on with your life. But these battles are to be given to God. But understand this, when God gets into the battle, he will require certain things. And he expects us to follow them. Now, it may be we don't want to. You got a problem once we start rebelling against God. God says, here's the setup. Now, you're going to follow the rules? And they followed the rules. That's why they were successful. They did it exactly as God wanted them to do. Matter of fact, the walls were very high. There was a series of walls. The gates were massive. You recall the old spiritual song that said Joshua fit the battle of Jericho and the walls came tumbling down. Isn't really quite that way, because Joshua wasn't responsible for the walls come tumbling down. They didn't have anything to do with the walls tumbling down. The only thing they did is that they were obedient to God. Now understand, if you want the walls of your Jericho, whatever you're facing, whatever mountain of an obstacle that's facing you, and you want that thing gone, you have to do it God's way. There's no way they could have penetrated the wall. They couldn't scale it. They couldn't blow it up. They couldn't. It was impossible. God had to fight the battle of Jericho for the children of Israel. And many of our battles in life, we cannot win on our own. We need God's help. Let God help you. But you have to do it God's way. God sometimes sets our efforts on the sidelines in order that others can see, as Paul said it in 2 Corinthians 4:7, and Paul said that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. That people will see the power of God at work, and it's not us at all. God just simply took care of the issue. It's always best to follow God's directions, located in his word, when trying to win a battle that seems impossible in life. Thirdly, the best way to hear from God is to often be quiet. I find it interesting in verse 10 that Joshua had commanded the people, notice verse 10, and Joshua had commanded the people, saying, ye shall not shout, nor make any noise with your voice, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day I bid you shout, then shall ye shout. Now, Lord, I understand you're laying out some rules here for me. But you're telling me now? And he's talking about when they're going around the wall, that I can't talk, I can't say anything? Isn't this a little strict? God says, this is the way it's going to be. But it seems, it doesn't make sense to me, God. God said, I don't care what it makes sense to you. You can't say anything. Wow. Joshua had a problem on his hands trying to get
all those people to be quiet. How in the world can you do that? Have you figured that out? You can't even get your own family to be quiet. And God says, you open your mouth, you're not going to be successful. The point is, will you obey me regardless? Maybe they learned their lesson by wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. God had to put such pressure on them. Eat manna. I mean, that's it. Struggle for 40 years. Now God says, this time do it right. Listen to me, and you'll be successful. And so God says, don't say a word. And I can hear them complaining. I can hear them at least wanting to complain. Such a temptation to complain about God's method. Why can't he just knock the walls down without this inconvenience of even walking around every day? Why do we have to even do this? Let alone I have to do it in silence. But you see, part of God's method is to get us to follow his leadership. And that includes following him whatever he asks. He always has a reason. You see, sometimes God wants us to be quiet. Now, that applies to everybody, whether you're a talker or you're a silent person. There are times when God wants us to be silent. Matter of fact, the psalmist talks much about being silent before God. Bible says we're to take time to be still and hear the voice of God. Psalm 46:10, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen, I will be exalted in the earth. But before that he says, be still and know that I am God. Psalm 4:4, stand in awe, sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still. God wants to speak to us. I think Satan, part of Satan's ploy, is to bombard us constantly with noise. Whether it's TV, whether it's radio, whether it's people, whether it's sounds, we are bombarded continually to where we can't even hear God anymore. God says, I want to talk to you. Find a place. Find a prayer closet. Get in this thing. I want to talk to you. Get rid of the noise and the sounds. How can you hear the voice of God if we're bombarded constantly by other noises? So I'm not sure that as they walked and they were not allowed to talk, that they started thinking about God. They might have started thinking, God, why are you doing this? But the more they walked around there, they started thinking about the conquest, the victory, that God cared enough to give them rules. It showed that God was involved in this thing. Matter of fact, it might even start to turn to praise to God. There's something about having a quiet time with God. You want a victory in your life? Try to find that quiet time where you can spend time with God. Folks, you get in that line, nothing. Nothing. You just follow me and be still. Ah, God wants so much to commune with us. Fourthly, victory is ours if we do not quit. In Joshua 6:16, and it came to pass at the seventh time when the priest blew the trumpets, Joshua said to the people, shout, for the Lord hath given you the city. The Lord, now, understand, the Lord has given you the city. Verse 20,
And the people shouted when the priest blew with the trumpets. And it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and took the city. Interesting, Dr. Alan Redpath, in his commentary on Joshua, suggests that many people never see the answers to their prayers simply because they've stopped one round short of their conquest of their personal Jericho. They may have gone six times around, but they just didn't go the seventh time around. And he says, we may have been doing the right things, but we simply stopped doing them short of the victory.
Welcome to the family. You can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. There's always room for more. To see my brothers and sisters, that mean so much to me. I think about the many times they've kept me in their prayers, and the countless ways they've always shown me that they care. And I know they'll still walk with me no matter what's ahead. Yeah, so much more than just their words, their lives have always said. Welcome to the family, you can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family. Welcome to the family. There's always room for more.
Glory. chamber. Jesus asked them to remember as he broke the bread and blessed their final day. For his time had come for leaving, and although he left them grieving, he said, "I'll return to take you home to stay."
Stone that troubles you. the tomb, then he can move that stone that troubles you.
Once more, 'cause my faults and all my frailties bring me here just like before, when strong and loving hands the pressure is applied, and oft times I tremble as he puts me through the fire.
I'll trust the potter's hand. He knows what's best for me. He has a perfect plan. These human eyes can't see. He's the potter, I'm the clay. He knows just how.
Though it seems I'll crumble down and I can hardly stand the pain, but into his own design he is molding me. I know, though my world it spins all around, I know the potter's in control.
I'll trust the potter's hand. He knows what's best for me. He has a perfect plan. These human eyes can't see.
Again.